Hello! In today's video, we start our discussion of the history of orchestration. We'll be tracing the art of orchestration from Monteverdi to Mozart in this video. What is orchestration? Well, orchestration is the art of arranging instruments to musical material, assigning each instrument or group of instruments to a specific musical passage. The art grew as the orchestra did, first following vocal polyphony, then to the more organized inventions. The art of orchestration has changed as the instruments of the orchestra did. With technological improvements in individual instruments, there was more invention in the orchestral writing. Let's start off our journey with the brilliant mind of Monteverdi. For most of his life, he wrote vocal polyphony in the form of madrigals for 4 to 8 voices. He published them in volumes named books, with each one of them becoming more and more complex. He created something called the solo madrigal, or monody, where one singer would sing accompanied by a continuo section, or keyboard, bass, and cello. In his opera L'Orfeo, he combines his writing of polyphony with a solo madrigal to create something new and daring. Orchestrations at the time were limited to monody and vocal polyphony played by instruments. No use of independent sections in the orchestra for harmonic or coloristic effects. There was no orchestra, just a conglomeration of instruments put together to make a pickup band for individual performances. Orchestras of the period had string parts, harps, lutes, and keyboard instruments in the basso continuo section. The strings had violins and viols, a mashup between a violin and a viola, sometimes as big as a cello seated on the lap. Most string writing was done in 5 parts, 2 violin, 2 tenor violin, and bass. Monteverdi used all of these in his opera L'Orfeo. Monteverdi did create some new effects with the orchestra for this opera. He is known as the first creator of orchestral effect. Monteverdi started writing indicative parts for the violins in fast runs, almost unheard of at the time. He also was the first to use pizzicato for effect, or and tremolo, the repeated measuring of notes. Each of these effects had a dramatic purpose, starting the tradition of more orchestral effects in opera writing than writing for the concert house. Let's take a look at some of his indicative writing of the time with the first ritornello in L'Orfeo. He obviously was writing in the vocal polyphony style. The 5 parts all have individual melody strains running together and against each other. The strings are playing the notes, but they aren't delineated in the score. This is another indication from the time period where composers would write music that could be played by any instrument that happened to be around at the time. The string section for L'Orfeo consists of violins, viols, and harp. The next time period only draws a little bit forward in the art of orchestration. The orchestra starts to become an organism made up of strings, including tenor violins and cellos, with a few winds, brass, and keyboards added. You can still find lutes in the orchestra as well. It was becoming a more defined body. Composers like Henry Purcell and Domenico Scarlatti drew on the same orchestra for their writing. They began to write for 4 parts instead of 5 in the previous generation. Also, string parts started to be written for the instrument in a more native voice, with arpeggios and repeated notes. It gave the string orchestra a more string-like flavor. Winds were being used singling and doubling the string parts. However, the parts were contrapuntal to create polyphony as seen in past generations. Some of the inventions were parts starting to purely accompany other parts in the texture of orchestral music. These are the first small steps away from contrapuntal writing to harmonic writing. The time of Bach and Handel was one of orchestral growth. Most orchestras added transverse flutes and 2 horns, making the orchestra in Handel's time 2 flutes, 2 oboes, 2 bassoons, 2 horns, 2 trumpets, drum, 4 string parts with the cello and the bass playing together, and keyboard instruments like the harpsichord and a few lutes. This double wind arrangement is standard for today and was in place in Bach's age. Trombones were used only in church orchestras and would have to wait wait a few generations to make their break into the concert house. Progressive composers of the day would use winds in different ways. Instead of just doubling the string parts, they would give them their own material. The advent of more accompanying patterns instead of continuous polyphony was the beginning of modern orchestration. Handel would use two distinct methods of handling the orchestra. One was the old pattern, where the oboes and bassoons would double the violin and the cello parts, playing the same melody at the same time. This was the accepted method of working with the orchestra at the time. The second method places the strings in one group, the oboes and bassoons in another, and the trumpets and the drums in a third. Three trumpets were used, two in the clarino range, very high so they could play chromatic notes, and one, the principal, in the lower fanfare range. These were natural trumpets with no valves, so they could only play open notes. As the notes get higher, there are more notes available to play, which is why the moving trumpet parts are in the clarino or high range. In Handel's Water Music, number 1, you can see two different ways of handling the orchestra. In the overture, Handel doubles the violin melody in the oboes, as it is standard practice of the time. At the allegro, the concertante, or solo first violin, begins the theme. Then the concertante second violin joins it. When the whole orchestra begins, the oboes join the first and second violins in their parts. The writing is very contrapuntal, without any other textures. Let's listen to that. Movement of his water music, Handel uses the new technique of accompaniment, along with using a woodwind as a solo instrument. The strings accompany the solo oboe. Let's hear that now. The next group of composers that evolved the art of orchestration was Mozart and Haydn. The biggest difference between the orchestrations of Bach and Handel and the orchestrations of Mozart and Haydn comes into the handling of orchestral texture. The orchestras went from handling polyphony to accompanying one another in various settings. A little of this could be seen in the previous period, but it really took root with Mozart and Haydn. The gates of modern orchestration opened up when composers began to accompany melodies instead of writing counter melodies. This new scheme allowed one group of the orchestra to provide harmony while the other provided motion. Their orchestral tutti then becomes the winds providing harmonic background as body and cohesion, and the strings providing energy and ornament. Pizzicato chords and arpeggios begin to be used in the strings as accompanying figures. Solo parts begin to stand out without the heaviness of contrapuntal forces weighing it down. Composers also started using groups of instruments for their tone color instead of just mixing them all together. The strings began to exploit their stringness in addition of double and triple stops on tutti chords, pizzicato and tremolo, the rapid alteration of notes eased by the new bow that was in style. The music began to be conceived for the orchestra directly instead of as a vocal or keyboard polyphony. The time period of Mozart and Haydn also brought the clarinet into the orchestra. It was named for its sound like that of a trumpet, or clarino in Italian, thus clarinetto, or small trumpet. During the period of accession, the clarinet sometimes stood in for or doubled the oboe. They were not universally played in all orchestras, and then some orchestras did not have them. They figured in most of Mozart's operas, but only 5 of his symphonies, and are only in Haydn's last 12 symphonies. One of the great orchestras of the period, the Mannheim Orchestra, was responsible for the idea of dynamics in orchestral works. They would use crescendi and decrescendi in their performances, making them in vogue around the world. Many other composers would use them in their works after Mannheim. Mozart spent some time in Mannheim in 1777 to 1778, where he heard the famous Electoral Orchestra play under the direction of Cannonbach. Directly afterward, he went to Paris and wrote his 31st symphony, the Paris Symphony. Let's take a look at it. You can see that Mozart varies how he works with the orchestra in the first few bars. It starts with a large orchestral tutti with all the instruments playing. Then it breaks into a new accompanying pattern with the first and second violins in octaves taking the melody in arpeggios until the winds join them with the entire harmony in large notes. The entire segment gets repeated, then the violas, celli, and basses along with the bassoons take off in a sweep of orchestral motion while the first and second violins have a melody that is supported by various woodwind players. The classical orchestra is in full effect with the new orchestration techniques abounding. For this newly complete orchestra, there were many choices and new freedom in the orchestrations. Composers could group the instruments into these classes: strings alone, woodwinds and strings, horns and woodwinds, horns and strings, horns, woodwinds and strings, woodwind, brass and drums, or tutti. The orchestra was already a three-part body. The strings and the woodwinds were harmonically self-contained. The brass would have to wait for valve horns and the use of trombones to become self-sufficient. The history of the art of orchestration is a long one, with a steady evolution from one style to the next. Each new sound or texture was created by an individual and then was passed around for all other composers of the time period. The journey from Monteverdi's pickup orchestra to the standard orchestras of Mozart and Haydn was a long and torturous one. Not all ensembles in Europe had the same instruments, and the composers had to write for what was available. That is why you see the acceptance of the clarinet come on in a patchwork fashion after its creation. This video series is indebted to the only book on history of orchestration called The History of Orchestration by Adam Karse. It was written in 1924, so some of the opinions in it are dated, but it is full of interesting stories about the progress of orchestras and the art of orchestration. Dover publishes it, so if you're really interested in this topic, I suggest picking up a copy. The next video will continue the evolution of the orchestra and the art of orchestration. If you liked this video and found it interesting, please give it a thumbs up. Don't forget to subscribe so you don't miss a video. My bibliography for this video is posted on my website, dominiqueroyam.com, and it's linked in the description box below. Let's continue the conversation on social media. It's Dominique Royam everywhere. Thanks so much and see you in the next video. Large notes. I swear, anytime I talk to a camera, it is time for her to come in and have an opinion. Sit in this topic, I suggest picking up a copy. We need to do that over. I sounded like shit.